All right. So, hello everyone. And starting with the oromotor perspectives of speech and feeding. So, before I proceed, I'm presenting here four examples. As you can see on the screen, there are four people who we are talking about. So, I would like to understand before moving that we are very clear with the speech and the language part. So, if any one of you can just tell me which one do you think has a speech problem? Ram is 4 years. It is hard to understand him when he talks. And his sounds are not clear and he's quiet when he speaks. Vinay is in high school. She has had the problem since she was young and she has trouble reading and writing and needs extra time to take tests. Mariam had a stroke. She can only say one or two words at a time and she cannot tell what she wants and needs. She has trouble following simple directions. There's another example, Sham, who had stroke. He's able to understand everything. He hears and speaks in full sentences, but he has slurred speech and is hard to understand. So if any one of you can tell me who has a speech problem and who has a language problem. Anyone can unmute and tell me?
Neha ma'am, Ram having a language problem and
okay.
Speak both.
Okay.
Vinay is again same.
Okay.
Mariam having a speech and Shyam having a speech, not a language issue.
All right. All
Mariam
right.
Even having a certain language issue, but Shyam having only the speech problem.
All right. Thank you so much. So according to you, all of them have some language problem for sure. And speech was added for Ram and Sham. Is that what you're saying? Okay. So I don't know the name, whoever answered, thank you. So Ram and Sham, as we can see, they have a speech problem. But Mariam and Vinay have a language problem. Ram and Sham do not have a receptive and expressive language problem here. So that is why I wanted to make it clear that in today's presentation, we are only going to talk about speech and not taking up the language part. So what do we understand by speech? Speech is how we say the sounds or the words, and it includes articulation, voice, and fluency. Articulation matlab, jaise ki hum bolte hain, hamare lips, hamari tongue, mouth, jaw, jaise bhi place ho rahe hai to create different sounds and words and phrases and ultimately sentences. Voice is how the vocal cords are making the sounds, whether we are low pitched, whether we are high pitched, we are talking loud, we are talking soft, like that. And fluency is the rhythm of our speech. Fluency mein hum dekhte hain kai bar, they're not very fluent or stammering hogi, stuttering hogi. या फिर बहुत मोनोटोन स्पीच होगी. सो ऑल दीज प्रॉब्लम्स प्रोसोडी की प्रॉब्लम होगी. सो टॉकिंग ऑफ द स्पीच साउंड डिसऑर्डर्स, वी हैव प्राइमरली थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ स्पीच साउंड डिसऑर्डर्स: आर्टिकुलेशन डिसऑर्डर, फोनोलॉजिकल डिसऑर्डर एंड मोटर स्पीच डिसऑर्डर. आर्टिकुलेशन डिसऑर्डर, एज आई मेंशन, इट इज द डिफिकल्टी इन मेकिंग द प्रिसाइज एंड एक्यूरेट मूवमेंट्स फॉर द स्पेसिफाइड साउंड्स. They may omit certain sounds, they may add certain sounds, they may distort or they may substitute certain sounds. In phonological disorder, we will see patterns of errors. Jaise ki bachcha ka nahi bol pa raha hai, so he will be saying ta. So everywhere you see a ka, he will be replacing it with ta. Kabhi kabhi they are not able to say the full word, so they will say half of it. Tree ko they will say t. Or computer ko they will just say computer. So those are the phonological problems. And motor speech disorder is where you have difficulty in planning and coordinating the precise movements. You know what to say, lekin hamara jo coordination hai within brain and the muscles are not able to coordinate the movements and make the precise sounds or the words. So considering the mouth to be a house, इसमें हमारा आता है फाउंडेशन. सो फाउंडेशन इंक्लूड्स द मोबिलिटी ऑफ द मसल्स, एजिलिटी जो स्पीड से वो मूव कर रहे हैं, प्रिसिजन हाउ प्रिसाइसली देयर आर मूवमेंट्स, स्टेबिलिटी ऑफ द मसल्स फॉर हाउ लॉन्ग दे कैन स्टे स्टेबल इन वन पोजिशन टू से द वर्ड्स और द सेंटेंसेस. लाइक व्हेन आई एम टॉकिंग टू यू नाउ, सो माई जॉ इज स्टेबल इन अ पोजिशन एंड आई कैन से लॉन्ग सेंटेंसेस. Endurance. My muscles can have, they have enough strength for enough length of time that helps me in talking. Dissociation is my jaw is working separately as compared to my lips and my tongue. मतलब सब कुछ साथ में नहीं move कर रहा है, हर किसी के movement intact है और separate है. And grating. Grating is the angles at which we talk. Like if we see for the tongue, okay, tongue and the palate. So tongue different positions pe touch karti hai palate ko. So we get different sounds. Or the jaw is in different positions, we get different sounds. So that is grating. All these components, they form the foundation of what we call as the oromotor apparatus, which we need for functional movements. So when this is adequate, the speech clarity will be normal along with the motor planning. So what happens in articulation and phonological disorders is that the foundation is adequate, the motor planning is adequate, there is only some issues with the awareness and the placements. So we go for the oromotor therapy to treat only the precisions primarily. In dysarthria, the functional movement is not intact. We usually see weakness of muscle in dysarthria. So the muscles are not strong enough to take the load or to endure and stay stable for enough length of time or for enough duration. They do not have the strength to articulate, to create the sound. However, in dysarthria, the motor planning is intact. In apraxia, the functional movement is intact. There is no issue with the oral apparatus in terms of their strength, stability, but there is a problem with the motor planning. So in this scenario, we usually see apraxia, and there can be apraxia in dysarthria when they are found together. So in this case, we will find there is weakness of muscles as well as motor planning issue. So what do we understand by oral motor function? Oral motor is a coordination and movement of heart tissue, soft tissue, vascular system, and the nervous control of face area and the oral cavity that forms the oral motor function of speech and feeding. So jo bhi hamara facial structure hai, oral cavity hai, andar pura structure hai oral cavity ke, all of them, they work together along with the vascular supply and the nerve supply, they form the oral motor function. इनमें से किसी में भी अगर कोई प्रॉब्लम होगी तो वो ओरोमोटर प्रॉब्लम होगी. सो टॉकिंग वेरी ब्रीफली अबाउट हाउ स्पीच साउंड्स आर प्रोड्यूस्ड. सो स्पीच साउंड प्रोडक्शन इज अ फोर स्टेप प्रोसेस व्हिच इंक्लूड्स रेस्पिरेशन, फोनेशन, रेजोनेंस एंड आर्टिकुलेशन. नाउ रेस्पिरेशन फॉर स्पीच एंड रेस्पिरेशन फॉर ब्रीदिंग दे आर डिफरेंट. सो व्हेन वी ब्रीद इट इज इक्वल. ब्रीदिंग में आप ऊपर वाले में देखेंगे आप इन द डायग्राम. So you have equal inhalation and exhalation. So the peaks are going in a equal manner. But in speech, the inhalation is very less, whereas the exhalation is long, so that we can talk. Because most of our speech is based on exhalation. So if the child cannot control the air, there will be high chances he's not able to talk. So respiration for speech is the shaped air basically. जो एयर हमारे माउथ से निकल रही है एंड वी आर कंट्रोलिंग इट टू फॉर्म द साउंड्स, दिस इज रेस्पिरेशन फॉर स्पीच. फोनेशन. सो नाउ द एयर हैज एंटर्ड इनटू योर लंग्स. ओके, लंग्स से वो ऊपर आना शुरू हुई एंड एक्सहेलेशन स्टार्ट होती है. इस प्रोसेस में नाउ इट पासेस थ्रू द वोकल कॉर्ड्स दैट आर प्रेजेंट इन द लैरिंग्स. जो वो दे पास थ्रू द वोकल कॉर्ड्स, देयर इज अ वाइब्रेशन इन द वोकल कॉर्ड्स. And this produces the phonation or the voicing. When the air further travels up, then it gets the larynx and pharynx get separated. Air either can go into the mouth or it can go into the nose. If it goes into the mouth, we have all the vowels and the consonants. If it goes through the nose, we have M, N, and NG. So M, N, and NG. These three sounds we get through the nose. So resonance is कहां से air निकल रही है, so that we get the particular sounds. And finally we have articulation. So when the air enters into the mouth, the articulators, they work together to form certain sounds, specific sounds, and they are combined together for co-articulation to form the words, phrases, and sentences. So we have many articulators in the mouth, the primary ones being jaw, tongue, lips. And then we have heart palate, alveolar ridge, velum, teeth, and uvula. Usually what we see that the child is not talking and the parents are very concerned that he's not talking because his tongue is not moving in the right way. Whereas the foundation of this articulators, it lies in the jaw. If the jaw is not stable, then no matter how much movement the tongue is making, the speech will not be there. He might not be able to articulate or it will not be clear. So first and foremost, the jaw is the prime articulator. Then we go on to the lips and finally is the tongue. So if you go in this hierarchy, speech clarity is automatically achieved. Talking of feeding, so feeding is the act or process of eating or being fed. Seeing feeding from two perspectives, oral sensory and oral motor. Oral sensory aspect involves how the mouth tissues perceive the food, the taste of the food, the temperature of the food, the texture of the food. Apart from this, the sensory aspect of smell and the sight, how the food is looking, what is the color, what is the smell, all these factors, they affect the feeding part, the sensory part of the feeding. Talking of the oral motor aspect of feeding, it involves how the mouth muscles function. So how strong they are, how well they coordinate, khana kidhar se chew ho raha hai, whether it is going in the right direction or not, whether the child is able to transfer the food or not, whether he's able to manipulate it and swallow it properly or not. So these all come under the oral motor part of the feeding. Now we should be very clear here that when we talk of the oromotor problem in terms of feeding, there is a difference between the child who cannot eat and who does not want to eat. So we all have preferences, you know, we like to eat certain things, we like spicy, we like salty, we like sweet. So something that the child does not want to eat usually comes in the picky eater. However, the child who has oral sensory issue or the oromotor issues will have the problem with taking the food. So he will not be able to eat. That is where we actually need the oromotor therapy. Agar koi bacha ek do cheeze nahi kha raha hai, so you don't really need to bother about it. But if he's not able to eat a wide variety of food because of certain textures, colors, temperature, taste, or those things, then it becomes an oromotor problem. Feeding is essential or a very integral part for many things like our growth. The whole nutrition comes through the food. So if the child is not eating properly, obviously the nutrition will be compromised. The growth will be affected. The development will be affected. Then eating is a very social experience. So when we can eat, we can share food, we can have anything that others are eating. So our social experiences are also better. Also, the children who are not able to manipulate the food properly, they are at a risk of choking because they don't know how to swallow safely. What are the oromotor milestones? Now talking of it. So oromotor development starts right from the birth when we have the rooting reflex. So rooting reflex is if you touch the child on the side of the mouth, as soon as the breast of the mother touches, the child moves towards that direction and starts to have milk. So the development starts from there and then the child will have suckle, swallow, the gag. So proceeding through those stages, I'll be quickly moving through the stages because I don't want to spend much time on this. However, these are the oromotor milestones which develop from 4 to 6 months. We will see as the child is transitioning to the we are weaning diet and he's transitioning to the semi-solid food. That's where the chewing pattern starts setting in. The gag reflex will start moving backwards and the suckling will start transitioning. So 7 to 9 months, we see that the cup drinking starts, the spoon feeding starts. So active transfer of food inside, side to center and center to side, it starts. The gag reflex further moves forward, backward. Around 1 year of age, true suck develops in the child. The upper and lower lips can move forward to take the bolus from the spoon. So there is very much improved coordination of the lips at this point of time. Rotary chew pattern starts developing and the gag movement, gag reflex moves to the pharyngeal walls, almost to a point where the mature gag reflex is found. At 13 to 15 months, we find emerging jaw, lip, tongue dissociation. So this is the point where your jaw, your tongue, your lips, they start working in a separate manner, in a dissociated manner, and some lip closure during chewing. So till this time, the kids are usually chewing with their mouth open. Around 15 to 16 months of age, they will start closing the mouth. 16 to 18 months, there will be internal jaw stability, increased dissociation. We will see reduced tongue protrusion and the swallowing, mature swallow pattern will start setting in from this age. 19 to 24 months, we see that they can use their tongues in all the ways. You know, they can go elevated, they can move it laterally, they can move it in depressed ways. So the tongue movements also, they are enhanced by 2 years. By 3 years, internal jaw stabilization occurs, tongue tip elevation for swallowing. So all the mature patterns, they set in by 3 years mostly. So why are these milestones important for us? And why is feeding and speech so correlated? That is because with the oral musculature development, we see the development of the sounds as well. So when the child starts drinking milk through breast or bottle, the lip closure is maintained for the sounds m, n. Likewise, we see for sucking, PB sounds, elevated tongue tip, TD sounds, greater jaw movements, then FVWLSZSR, elevation of posterior of tongue for swallowing, KNG sounds, and spreading of tongue during swelling, R and R sounds. So as we proceed to the hierarchy of oral development, oromotor milestones, these sounds, they develop gradually as the muscles are coordinating. So what are the different issues that we can see from the oromotor perspective? If the child has a speech problem, if the child has a feeding issue, what do we expect to see? Talking of the speech issues first, you might see, so these are various things that might happen. Okay, there can be combination of issues in a child. So one thing that can happen is if there is disturbance in neuromuscular control, then it will cause difficulty in producing sounds. The speech can be slurred, there can be difficulty in controlling respiration, abnormal loudness, rhythm, etc. If there is a problem in positioning or programming or sequencing of the muscular movements, so if the child might be able to say isolated sounds correctly, but he might not be able to say them together correctly in co-articulation in terms of words, in terms of phrases, in terms of sentences, then there can be difficulties in making the non-speech movements. So oral imitations, what we call. So if we ask the child to open the mouth or close the mouth, purse the lips, pucker the lips, so he's not able to do that. These problems are also under oromotor aspect. Then kids who have hearing problem, their speech can be affected, which can be helped with the oromotor therapy. Then in autism, emotional disturbance or mental retardation, they also cause very unusual prosodic variation. So we might see robotic speech, we might see very loud, very soft. So all those rhythmic problems can occur. Because of all these things, the child might get very frustrated and he might avoid to talk at all because it is very difficult to form the sounds and it is very difficult to talk, or difficult being understood. So the child might be saying a full sentence, but there is no clarity, nobody is able to understand it. In that case, it is very frustrating for the child. Then stuttering or stammering also is one thing that you can see in speech issues. Others, you can see the child is adding extra sounds or words, he is deleting certain sounds, he is elongating the words, he is making jerky movements, or involving unusually too much movements of the head, blinking the eyes together. So all those things that we see, they are the speech issues under oromotor problems. What do we expect to see if the child has feeding issues? So the child might be a picky eater. He might take too long to eat. So the duration of the meal will be very, very long. Or he keeps the food in the mouth. The child cannot suck or spit. There is delayed advance of textures and other feeding milestones. There is inefficient chewing. Food will be left in the mouth if you ask the child to open the mouth after some time. There might be drooling, gagging, coughing or choking. And all of these factors lead to low intake of food and compromised nutrition. So how do we manage these problems? We do manage it with the oromotor therapy or the oral placement therapy as we practice. So what are the goals of this therapy? It is based, the goals are starting with the awareness. What is in the mouth? Which structures are present? Where are the lips of the child? Where is the tongue? Where is the jaw? Where is the palate? How am I supposed to touch where or bring my teeth together to chew? So all these awareness is the first goal of oromotor therapy. Then comes the placement. So if I want to make a sound T, I'll have to teach the child where he should place his tongue and touch the palate so that he can produce the target sound. Adequate strength. So the child might know that I need to touch there, but there is no strength in the jaw to keep it stable. There is no strength in the tongue to elevate it. So we need to increase the strength of the muscles of the mouth or the articulators for the speech and feeding. The child might just prefer to swallow down the food because it is too much effort for chewing. So he will avoid that effort and just simply swallow the food. Muscle memory. So muscle memory is that we just teach the child once that this is how you have to say buh, and the child does not remember. So we have to give him enough repetition so that the muscles can memorize this is the movement I need to create for a certain sound. Okay, this is what we need, what we call muscle memory. Then to improve the differentiation of oral movements. In this, there are three things: dissociation, grading, and fixing. Dissociation is the separation of movement based on stability and adequate strength. So dissociation means like I want to pick up a glass from the table. Okay, so I'll just extend my hand and I'll pick up the glass. Now I want to drink the water. So now I've picked up the glass, but I want to bring it to my mouth to drink the water. So this movement from the elbow to the mouth is a graded movement. My hand is moving in a certain manner to bring the cup to my mouth, which is called gradation. So kitna movement mujhe chahiye taki mera glass mere lips tak aa jaye and I can have water is called grading. Same thing if we see in the mouth, dissociation is that the jaw is working separately, the tongue is working separately. अगर मेरा ये सब कुछ साथ में काम नहीं कर रहा, अलग अलग काम नहीं कर रहा, then everything will start moving together. So if I'm talking, it will be like goes off oromotor therapy because my tongue is stuck with the jaw. It is not moving separately. So there is no clarity, although I read the sentence. Okay, dissociation मतलब everything has to work in separation. Then grading is segmented movements. And fixing is an abnormal posture. So if I'm not able to extend my arm or bring it here, so what I'll do is I'll fix my arm in a straight manner and I'll move my whole body forward to pick up the glass. So I'm taking the help of my bigger muscles to help me lift the glass. In the mouth also, I will take the help of other muscles. So I might just say, I am very, the goals of oromotor therapy. You might just feel that, I'm so happy talking about it. But the fact is that my jaw is not enough stable. So I'm using my lips and my other muscles of the face to stabilize it so that I can talk. So all those, all these things, these fixings are something that we avoid so that the child can speak clearly. Then transitioning to functional speech. So as soon as we teach the child how to produce a sound or how to make a certain movement, we immediately transition to a functional speech. So first we go to sounds, we go to words, phrases, and sentences. To maximize intelligibility, that is clarity, and to provide nutrition. So the ultimate goal of oromotor therapy is to develop normalized oromotor functions for feeding and speech. So who will benefit from it? OMT, oromotor therapy, or oral placement therapy can be used for clients of all ages and abilities, for dysarthria, apraxia, fluency disorders, hearing losses, any articulation issues, phonological issues. So any kind of speech sound disorders can be benefited from this particular therapy. And especially kids who do not respond to the traditional therapy, who cannot, if we tell them, produce ah, and they are not understanding, or say mm, they are not able to copy you. So those who are not able to get benefit from a audio, auditory, visual therapy, that is the traditional speech therapy, oromotor therapy can be of huge benefit. Then kids or adults with reduced mobility, reduced agility, reduced precision, and reduced endurance of oral musculature will benefit from this therapy. So what are the general considerations when we talk of oromotor challenges? First and foremost thing that we need to look into is the medical issues. We need to look into the metabolic disorders, respiratory disorders, cardiac disorders, because, excuse me, please mute yourself. Okay, so any medical issue will directly affect the oral musculature and the ability of the child to speak or eat. So we have to speak, especially like when it comes to reflux, the children having reflux problem will have feeding issues. Kids having dysphagia will have very clear feeding issues. Kids having respiratory disorders, we will see frequent infections, oral infections, and they'll be affecting the speech and the feeding. So medical issues is something that we first look out for. Then comes the structure of the oral musculature. How's the palate, lips, tongue? There is any cleft, symmetry, size? What is the structure? Because we cannot, we do not intend to make it normal, but normalize the movements. Normalizes within the normal range functionally. So if the structure of the mouth is such, or particular hard tissue or soft tissue is such that we cannot change, so we will try to make it the best possible within the structural limits. Then we need to work on the dissociation, like I talked about it earlier. So dissociation, first we need to dissociate head from the body, then jaw from the head, lips, face, eyes. Many a times when our kids talk, the eyes will be blinking too much, or if we ask them to close the eyes, then the jaw also stretches out like in a big smile. That is because the eyes and the lip or the cheek muscles, they are not dissociated. So they're all moving together. So we need to dissociate them so that every muscle can work at its optimal level. Then lips from the jaw and tongue from the jaw. Why is this dissociation important? Again, I'm talking in terms of speech. So lips have to be dissociated from the jaw to create the following sounds as mentioned on the screen. We need the retraction, we need the protrusion, which works independently from the jaw movements. So jaw will be stable in one position and I'm able to retract, I'm able to protrude to create oo, oo, fur, ver, sher, jer, those sounds. Dissociation of tongue from the jaw. So we need the tongue protrusion, tongue retraction, tongue elevation, and the back of tongue side spread. And all this has to work independently from the jaw or the lip musculature for the sounds to be clear. And especially the tongue stability comes into a huge role when it comes to co-articulation. And that can be achieved if the jaw and lip stability and dissociation has been achieved already. Another thing that is very important and we need to look into is the sensory issues. So talking of the sensory aspect, many sensory systems are working in the mouth. The major one is the tactile. So we see five sorts of sensitivities: hypersensitive, hypersensitive, mixed sensitivity, fluctuating sensitivity, and tactile defensiveness. Hypersensitive is when the child needs more input to register the sensation that is being provided. So these kind of kids, they will overstuff their mouth, or they need maybe too cold, too hot, too spicy to know what is in their mouth. They will not be able to feel the structures. So if I'm not able to feel my tongue, my teeth, my palate, how will I talk clearly? I just don't know where my structures are moving. So these kids having hyposensitivity or low registration, they will have these problems. With the hypersensitive kids, they cannot tolerate the touch of anything. So if you touch their face, or if you want to give them an oral massage, brushing is especially a huge problem with hypersensitive kids. And they would like to swallow everything very quickly, and they will be preferring small bites. With the hyposensitive kids, the kids, they usually prefer to use their hands to eat because they need to feel the food also. But with hypersensitive kids, we see they prefer the use of spoon or fork, or they would like to be fed by someone else because they do not like to touch the food much. So usually we see what is happening in the body is happening in the mouth. So if there is tactile hyposensitivity or tactile hypersensitivity, in general, we might see the same pattern. However, it is not always true. Mixed sensitivity is in the different areas of the mouth. We will see somewhere it is hyposensitive, somewhere it is hypersensitive. So the child might be hyposensitive on the palate and the tongue. However, he's very sensitive to touch on the cheeks, the lips, or the outer surface of the mouth. Fluctuating sensitivity is, Fluctuating sensitivity is the child has, today he is hyposensitive, tomorrow he might be hypersensitive. Or maybe morning he is hyposensitive, by evening he is feeling hypersensitive. So whatever changes are happening in his whole body and the oral musculature, oral system, those changes are also affecting his sensory issues. So fluctuating sensitivity can change over the day, within the day, or over the week. So depends. Tactile defensiveness is the child develops a defensiveness, or he is aversive to something because of a negative experience. So something maybe was forced into my mouth, or I was just forced to eat something and I developed a tactile defensiveness and I will not open my mouth. There is no sensory issue, there is no motor issue maybe, but because I've had a very unpleasant experience, so I'm not willing to experience anything now. This is tactile defensiveness. Then there can be sight, smell, hearing, body awareness, movement issues. And when we assess these things, we always work outside in. That is first from the bigger muscles. I'll start with his hands, shoulders, mouth, outside. And then I move on to the inside of the mouth. And leads to maximum input. First, I will start only with the fingers or maybe some cloth, and then check up to the vibration levels. Another thing to be considered is the muscle tone. So we see different features with the kids having low muscle tone and with the kids having high muscle tone. And it is not always that any kid who is having an oromotor issue will always have a low muscle tone. They can have high tone as well. So what do we expect to see? In the low muscle tone kids, we will be seeing a ragdoll posture. They will, most of the times, they'll be slumping down their chairs. They will be having drooped shoulders, or they will be taking the support of the table in front of them. And the body follows the gravitational pull regardless of the position. However, in the high tone kids, there is general body extension. So you will see them, you know, little tightened up all the time in asymmetrical pattern. The head control, there is weak control, which results in head back during feeding for low tone kids. And for high tone, there is asymmetrical posture with usually retraction on one side. With low tone kids, we usually see the open mouth posture. The mouth will always be open even in the rest position while feeding. They cannot eat with their mouth closed. And with high tone, the jaw is rigid. It is generally fixed either in open position or in closed position. And the grading is also poor. With the lips, as I mentioned, we will find open mouth posture as a habit because there is no strength to close it. When they close it, there is very reduced pressure. They're not able to hold it or purse the lips strong enough, and they have difficulty protruding and retracting. In high tone kids, retraction pattern is done with effort and there is difficulty with closure and rounding. Tongue, for the low tone kids, it might appear oversized, flaccid with rounded tip. For high tone, it will be retracted within the oral cavity. The tip is frequently elevated. The sensory input for low tone kids, they usually need a high sensory input. So high taste foods, overstuffing of foods. Whereas for the high tone, they are oversensitive to the high textures or high tastes. And articulation, we see different patterns with the low tone and the high tone. So now, very much in brief, I'm talking about, these are just general things I'm going to tell you what you can do at home as parents. So what can I do? This, whatever we talked before, was the therapeutical part. But what can I do as a parent? So first thing that you can do as a parent is developing phonation on command. Phonation on command, as we discussed, phonation is shaped air. So first and foremost, teach the child to blow, to control the air through the mouth. So if the child can blow and teach the child to blow so that he can control the air and exit it through the mouth. That is why we say blowing is a very important aspect. That is because we need the air to create the sound. We will often see the child can, he's trying his level best to talk, but there is no voicing. The voicing happens when phonation happens. Phonation happens when the child can control the air and bring it to the mouth, wherein blowing comes and plays a huge role. Another thing that you can do is vocalization on command. Vocalization is to evoke a sound from the child when requested. It might be the sound that you want, it might not be the sound that you want, but evoking a response. If I'm saying, say, ba, if he's saying, it is not the correct sound, but he's vocalizing on my command. So whatever, if we get the correct sound, it's very good. If we do not get the correct sound, still do not discourage, but get the sounds on command so that the compliance of the child can increase. So why do we find the vocalization such a difficult problem? It can be because of the articulation, motor planning, apraxia issues, as we talked. It can be because of the lack of imitational skills. So very often we find that the kids who are not able to talk or having oromotor issues will also have very poor oral imitational skills. So if we develop those imitational skills, there is a good chance that... imitation skills, they play a huge role. However, in oral motor therapy, we do not rely too much on the imitation skills, but eventually, over the period of time, as the child progresses, he starts learning with the imitation skills because we start teaching them from the beginning stage. Lack of motivation. There is absolutely no motivation for the child to talk when everything can be achieved by gestures, by not saying it, by pulling, by doing something, by using a sign. I do not need to talk. So lack of motivation is also one factor that the child is not vocalizing. And the behavioral issues. Sometimes we just see oppositional behaviors that I will not do it, or I do not want to do it, or there has been huge demand and the child has now become defensive or aversive to any sort of cooperation for speech issues. So when we talk of developing imitations, start with the object imitation or the gross motor imitations. Now these can be interchanged. You can either start with the object part or the gross motor part, whichever the child best responds to. Then move on to the fine motor imitation, head and oral imitation, and finally the verbal imitation. A few strategies that we are going to share for vocalization on command. There are many, many other things. There's another webinar on it, but I'm sharing 2 to 3 strategies here. So the first one is start by imitating their vocalizations if the child is vocal in play. Most of the times we see that the child, when he's playing on his own, he's creating a lot of sounds. So try ki aap, you start imitating those sounds and try to get the response back, or make an inventory of what sounds he can make and start working on those particular sounds rather than working on the sounds that he's not capable of making right now. work on what he can do, focus on the strength areas rather than what he cannot do right now. So if the child can produce fervor, girl, whatever sound during the play, work with those sounds and you start imitating. If the child is saying, ah-ba, start imitating, ah-ba. So look for the reaction and do not force a reaction. You start playing with the child and the vocalizations will most probably improve. Separate speech practice from the language practice. So speech drills, they should not be very, very long, maximum 2 to 5 minutes of speech drills. So we are focusing only on the speech aspect, the sound aspect, the word aspect, or getting those clarity, speech clarity part. Language is a huge aspect. So do not mix them both. Give your speech drills separate time. Give your language thing almost the whole of the day. So if I'm talking about bubbles, so I'm focusing on sound bubbles. So bubbles will go on for 2 to 3 minutes, but this is bubble ko hum pop karte hain, let's pop the bubble, and those kind of things, they will go on as a separate thing. So make your speech drill short so that it is not frustrating for the child. Keep it simple, single words or sound. Don't try to get whole complicated lot of words, microwave, cauliflower. Those kind of words should not be the beginning words. So start with very simple things which you can introduce in play. So if I'm playing with a car, I'll be like whoosh, or something fell from the chair. Oh, it fell. Oh, or he liked something. Wow, pop. Bubble. So small power words that the child is attracted to and where you can provide the modulation of voice. Voice modulation, the child will be very attracted to it. So that also helps in developing vocalization on command. I'm sorry, the PPT is stuck. All right. Another is introducing supportive tools. So if the child is not able to imitate, if the child is not able to vocalize on its own, then we start using the tools which we use in the oromotor therapy. That is why we do not rely heavily on the imitations. We use the tools to produce the sound, teach the child where he needs to place his tongue, where he needs to place his lips, where he needs to place his jaws, and then teach them certain sounds from the beginning. Sensory issues, as I mentioned, is another area that has to be looked into. So if the child is hypersensitive or hyposensitive, we need to bring them both to the optimal arousal zone where they can function best for the appropriate speech and feeding. So for sensory and tone, what you can usually do is the oral massage. So oral massage, we almost all of us are doing. The idea is not to do too much of massage of the muscles, but to do it according to the child. For a low tone child, we should do it in short spurts so as to activate or stimulate the muscle. For a high tone child, we need to relax the muscles. So it should be sustained massage. Okay. Another thing that you can use is a toothed. So toothed is a sponge kind of thing, the swab, it has a spongy thing in front of it and it gives a good amount of oral stimulation. Wiping the face, a child who is very hypo or both the things we use, but again, you know, the strategies change according to the individual child. So these are general things I'm discussing here, what you can use. Wiping the face over the throughout the day with different textures of cloths is another strategy that can be used. And vibrations. Vibrations, if you're using for a low tone child, should be used in quick, rapid motions. If you're using for a high tone child, it should be a little sustained so that it can cause relaxation of the muscles. But vibrations should be used very, very judiciously. We have often come across that too much vibration is given to the child and they develop issues that were not existing, especially the mouthing issues or the drooling issues. They are very often caused by wrong usage of vibrations. What can you do for the jaw strength? So we have a tool called bite blocks. These are very, very good for developing dissociation and grading for the jaws. So it helps in developing the jaw strength, the strength so that the jaws can work together for chewing and articulation. Gum chewing is another strategy that can be used for developing the strength of the jaw. Chewy tubes and solid food placement. So solid food placements you can do directly on the molar, the back teeth of the child from the right side, from the left side, and teach him how to chew. The direct placement of the food on the molars, it reflexively, it introduces the chewing part also reflexively. Also, because the placement is directly there, the child will first have to function with his jaw. For the lips, the common strategies that can be used at home are the spoon feeding, straw sucking, cup drinking, and horn blowing. Horn blowing or whistle blowing, these things you can use. For tongue, you can use the straw sucking. You can use elevators and lateralizers. They help in making the movement of the tongue from midline to side, right side and left side, and upwards and downwards. Horn kit or the whistles, they are very good. They help in tongue retraction, because retraction is what we need for speech and feeding, not the protrusion. And placement. Placement can be taught with the help of vibrations. A little bit of vibrations can be used to teach where to place the tongue. Talking of few feeding techniques that can be used, it is one thing that you can use is food play. So the kids who are highly aversive to even the sight of food, involve them in making, you know, it fun. Just let it be a game. Let's cook, let's mix, let's create a batter, let's just mix, whisk, do anything with the food. Do non-flame cooking, involve them in the kitchen aspect or the food aspect. Another strategy is food chaining. Food chaining is adding on a little component of new food to whatever the child is existingly eating. So if he likes to eat rice and he doesn't like curry, so I'll introduce a very, very small amount of curry, almost hidden in the rice, very just a speck of it, and gradually keep on increasing. So food chaining is building upon the existing food items and keep on adding the new ones. Portion control. So children who are taking very long in eating, who are having problem solving, so don't give them a huge portion to start with. Start with a smaller portion and gradually increase. And make small changes. If you want to introduce anything new, do not start it straight away if the child is eating apple and you directly move to watermelon. So first transition one aspect. So if I'm taking apple, I might like to move to guava, which is again white in color, looks almost similar, has almost a similar texture, but only the flavor has changed. So I'll only change one component at a time. It can be flavor, it can be size, it can be texture, it can be temperature. So don't change everything at a time. So these are few things that can be done at home. And this is very quickly in brief about speech and feeding from the oromotor perspective. But it's a huge topic. And if there's anything in particular you want to take up, we will again have a detailed webinar. So that was about it, dear parents and professionals. And now we are open to the questions.
Thank you, Dr. Neha, for the webinar. Now, quickly, we'll be going on to the questions now. And in the chat box, there are some questions, Dr. Neha. You can go through them and accordingly, we can answer. Okay.
Will my child speak? If not, how? One second. Okay, I'm starting from Darshita Srividya. If sensory issues will be there, child can't talk. Yes, if sensory issues are there, child might not be able to talk. If I do not like the feel of my tongue touching my palate, if I do not like my lips closing together, I will try to avoid those movements. So I will try to avoid making those sounds, and thereby I will not like to talk. This is about hypersensitivity. If I cannot feel what is there in my mouth, I don't know where my tongue is, I don't know where my teeth are, I don't know, I have absolutely no awareness, then obviously I cannot talk. So if the sensory issues are high, yes, the child will have difficulty talking. What exercises, Mithun Pawar, What exercises could be done to produce sh and r sound in ASD child? Are these the only sound that are problematic? Rest all are clear. If we have Mithun Pawar. Okay, I'm moving on to the next one. My child will forget words if I forgot to repeat next day. I think, Dr. Lalit, we can directly interact with the parents and getting the questions in breakage here.
Yes, yes. I think that will be better. Parents, you can ask your questions one by one. Dr. Neha, please kindly take up the queries.
Yeah, sure.
Hi, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Ma'am, please go ahead with your query.
Hello. Hi, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. My son is 5.5 years, ma'am. Actually, the thing is, he's a very picky eater. And whenever he's eating, he doesn't like to eat some chunks like onion, tomato. If he sees that, immediately he's gagging and immediately he's trying to vomit or spit it out. So I don't know, what is that, hyposensitivity, or I just want to know what kind of exercises or to prevent this, what kind of exercises I have to do.
See, first and foremost, as I mentioned, we will have to look into the sensory issues of the child since he's having problem with the chunks. So it can be the size problem, it can be the swallowing issue. So exercises, as of now, it is really difficult for me to tell you. But first,
As soon as he sees the chunks, immediately he's gagging. Like, it's not like he's eating also. Whenever he sees it while having rice or something, immediately he has that issue.
So go for very small pieces initially and gradually increase the size of the bite rather than moving on to a direct big chunk. Okay. His musculature probably is not ready to take a big chunk, and he has developed that memory that as soon as I see a big chunk and my gag reflex sets in, because I've had an unpleasant experience previously. So rather than exposing the child to the same experience again and again, I would rather suggest go for very, very small size bites. If you have, suppose, a carrot piece in your rice, break it down before giving it to the child. So let him.
But he has no issues with having vegetables. Only certain things, coriander leaves. So certain thing he has that issue. So I couldn't figure out like why he's doing that.
Yeah. So whatever is the problem area, whatever food items are a problem area, don't present them as a whole over and over again, rather than break down the size. If coriander leaf is a problem, make it very, very fine, very small. You can just tear it up with your hand and mix it with the rice. So it is not very visible. Okay. Visibility, his vision is only causing the problem. First, forget about taking it in. Okay. So first the food has to be acceptable visually. Then only it will be acceptable palatably.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Myself, Pinky Kumar.
Yes, ma'am.
My son is now 10 year old. Till 9, he having a no drooling problem.
But thank you, ma'am.
1 year, he having a drooling problems. Like, and now he's a verbal child. Clarity is still an issue, not so clear. But I don't understand. Till 9, he having no drooling. From the last 1 year, he having come up with a drooling. Why is this?
Has there been any change in diet or a medication part?
No, ma'am, nothing is changed. Even now he eat and everything, crunchy, hard, soft, anything he can eat now. There is no, like, in initial days he was very picky eater, but now he's a very good eater. No problems from my side, no problems from him side, but the drooling is come up, like whenever he concentrates something, whenever he attention something, then the drooling is the more. And the rest of the time, yes, but attention time, it's more.
How is the muscle tone of the body?
Muscle tone now, as per the his OTs said, they said it's good. Now it's okay. Like, he's playing basketball, football, cricket. Everything is in on the place.
Okay.
But the cooling, I don't know why it's arise at this age.
See, it can arise at any age. Drooling can be because either the saliva production has increased, or he is not able to control the amount of saliva that is in the mouth. Okay, so if the muscle tone is to be seen here, first I'll see the light and lifestyle changes, then positioning of the body. If the child is in the attention pose and he's with the open mouth posture and looking down, the drooling is expected to happen. Okay.
Yes.
So because there is no lip seal or the oral musculature working to seal it. So probably consciously he was doing it till 9 years, and now over the period of time, maybe you also felt that, okay, things are sorting and they have sorted out. The child is also relaxed a bit and he has just developed the habit of keeping the mouth open. So if that habit has developed or any other oral habit has developed, that will lead to drooling.
It's like, it's mostly it's in a behavior issue. Like he had developed a certain behavior rituals by that, like he's not able to close and when he attention to something.
We can't really call it a behavioral issue. It is a habitual thing. Maybe
it's a ritual. He make some ritual. He's not able to, like, it's, if I constant say that close your mouth, then might be it will be after 2-3 months it will be over.
Yes, because if the muscle tone is fine and he is just habitually opening it, you just need to create the lip seal and he can control the saliva. It is just unconsciously happening.
Unconsciously is happening. Like, you know, he's a concentrated in the studies and everything. Attention is now improved. So yes. Might be on that time he's not able to remember ki I have to
close my mouth. And when the child is in this position looking down, the drooling happens.
Fine. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay.
बट द प्रॉब्लम इज विथ र एंड श. जब र और श बोलना है तो उसके लिए मुझे माउथ ओपन करके हवा बाहर छोड़नी पड़ती है. तो उसमें उसका स जैसे सुनाई देता है. तो ऐसे होता है कि उसका जो ब्लोइंग एक्टिविटी है वो भी कराता हूं मैं, लेकिन उसका जो श है वो क्लियर नहीं है, फ्लुएंट स्पीच नहीं है उसमें. ठीक है. और डाइट में ही मतलब ऐसा कोई भी इशू नहीं है, जो हम खाते हैं वो भी वही खाता है. मतलब ऐसे कुछ अलग इशू मुझे लगता नहीं है. च्यूइंग भी कोई इशू नहीं है. हार्ड ऑब्जेक्ट्स भी जो है वो करता है, मतलब खाता है, जैसे खारी ऐसे है या फिर अलमंड्स है तो वो खाता है फोड़ के अच्छे से. तो ऐसा कोई इशू नहीं है. लेकिन दो चीजें हैं सिर्फ कि र और श का प्रोडक्शन मुझे अच्छा नहीं लगता, उसकी क्वालिटी ऑफ साउंड अच्छी नहीं लगती है. तो उसके लिए कुछ स्ट्रेटेजी हो सकती है क्या?
बाकी सारे साउंड्स क्लियर हैं?
हाँ, बाकी सारे ऑलमोस्ट. मतलब और जो थोड़े डिफिकल्ट है कि जैसे क्ष है, ज्ञा है, वो मैंने ट्राई नहीं करवाया, लेकिन बाकी सब साउंड्स क्लियर है. जब वो बोलता है तो समझ में आता है अच्छे से कि क्या बोलना चाह रहा है.
सी, श और र एज सच लेट ही डेवलप होते हैं, बट फॉर द स्ट्रेटजीज श अगर आप बोलेंगे तो श के लिए हमें टीथ क्लोजर चाहिए और वो चाहिए, हमारा एयर बाहर आना चाहिए. तो दोनों कंडीशंस को जब आप फुलफिल कराएंगे, यहाँ पे आप उसको एक आइसक्रीम स्टिक दे सकते हैं बिटवीन द टीथ एंड आस्क हिम टू से श. तो पहले वो कराइए, आप टीथ क्लोजर कराइए विद द हेल्प ऑफ एन आइसक्रीम स्टिक एंड आस्क हिम टू से विद अ बर्स्ट ऑफ एयर फॉर श. फॉर र वी नीड द टंग रोलिंग इनसाइड, सो यू कैन यूज अ डेंटल फ्लॉस काइंड ऑफ थिंग और उसको आप लेके आप उसका टंग रोल बैक करा सकते हैं फॉर र. लेकिन अगर उसने बोलना कब शुरू किया?
एक डेढ़ साल पहले.
तो र और श वैसे भी डेवलप होने में हम अगर वो देखते हैं क्रोनोलॉजिकल एज तो उसमें टाइम लगता है. बट दिस इज अ डेंटल फ्लॉस जो आप यूज कर सकते हैं और उससे आप टंग को रोल बैक कराने में हेल्प कर सकते हैं फॉर र साउंड.
ओके. डेंटल क्लॉस क्या बोलते हैं उसको मैडम?
डेंटल फ्लॉस.
डेंटल फ्लॉस.
फ्लॉस FLOSS.
फ्लॉस. ओके ओके मैडम, थैंक यू.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I want to know, my son, he's 12 years old. He's slightly verbal. Some speech clarity issues are there. Mm-hmm. But I specifically want to know, like, you know, for certain sounds like third, the tip of the tongue, it is very feeble. And the lip pressure also. Yes, I feel. I think going by your description, I feel he comes under the low tone category. He's not putting much pressure. So any exercises can you suggest, please?
See, there are many exercises that we can do, but then as I mentioned first, there is not just ki tongue ki movement karai and the speech clarity will happen. We need to work on the jaw, the lips, and then the tongue part. So for tongue, I've already mentioned you can go for vibrations. You can give the vibrations on the palatal part and tell him where to place it. If you think that is only the issue, however, considering what you have told me, I don't think that should be the only issue. So work with an oral placement therapist or an oromotor therapist and work from the right way, working on jaw, working on lips and for tongue. But again, coming back to your question, you can give some vibrations on the palate at the point where we're supposed to say ter and der. That you can do. And you can use lateralizers and elevators, the tool that I've shown in my PPT. Those tools you can get and you can teach the tongue tip lateralization and elevation. You can apply some honey on the palate and ask him to lick it over there to produce that sound.
And for the lip?
For the lip, you can ask him to hold the ice cream stick in between the lips for sustained amount of time. So for 20 counts, 30 counts, 50 counts, increasing.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Hello, okay, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Madam, good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Madam, I'm from Vizag. My children is talking, age is now 3.58 now. He's speaking only Amma Amma in Telugu.
Hmm.
Amma Amma in Telugu. His loud some sounds are there sometimes. Is some speaking. Hmm. Now, other than he's not talking now.
Hmm.
Tell me, ma'am, what is suggestion?
Suggestion would be that you start with the oromotor therapy or the oral placement therapy because whatever sounds he is producing are not meaningful, but he has at least two sounds to start with, a and ma, and we can build upon it. Okay, so using those two sounds, we can start with the combinations. And again, without seeing the child, I cannot comment much. For the random sounds that he is making, it can be vocal stimming, which can be due to the auditory issues as well. So if you've got a sensory profiling of the child done, then you must be aware of it. If not, please get a sensory profiling of the child done for that issue. Okay, and okay. Start with an oromotor therapy straight away.
Thank you.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, my son is 3.5 years old. Okay. From the explanation you gave, I think he comes under this phonological disorder where he says only half the words.
Okay.
Like if I say bus, he will say only burr.
Hmm.
Or if I say, like there are other words like apple, he will say apple. Or ball, he will say ball.
Hmm.
For lorry, he says lolly.
Hmm.
Like that sound will not come. For lorry, he says lolly. How do I motivate him to tell the entire word? Then say half the words.
See, if there is articulation and phonological issue, it will not just come by motivation. You okay. need to get it corrected. So if the child is habitually not omitting the sounds from the end, it can be an articulational disorder as well and may or may not be the phonological one. Okay. So if you're not referring to any speech therapist or oral placement therapist as of now, just get an assessment done and you can get a clear idea if this can be done. However, if you want to stress, then you can teach him to break the word for now, teach him and then combine, but do not teach all the words like that, otherwise he'll start speaking in breakage. So ba, sa, and the child should have enough sound inventory so that we expect him to say all the sounds. If he doesn't have the sound sa, da, 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 we cannot expect him to say those. Okay, so he will not say the word bus. So to say the complete word, first he should have the complete sound inventory. If he does not have that, work on the sounds first. If he has that, then see whether it is the motivational issue, which I don't think so. Then rule out the articulation and the phonological issue.
Okay. What kind of assessment do we?
For us, we do a speech assessment. You can refer to a speech therapist or an oral placement therapist who can clear out your doubt.
Okay, ma'am. Fine. Thank Hello, you. Ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, do you assess for other, like, I stay in Hyderabad.
Yes, we
do. So, do you do
online
assessment for?
Yes, we do.
Okay. So, therapy also, do you provide online, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay. How can I reach you, ma'am?
You can drop us an email. Dr. Lalit can share the email in the chat box. Please have a look. Or you can contact us on the clinic number that was shared on the pamphlet.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, my son is 10 years old.
Ji.
And he never eats any type of fruit, any, and even he does not like to eat any sour, pulpy, and jelly form kind of things. So, ma'am, what should I do for even? I want that even one or two fruits that he should eat.
Ma'am, यहाँ पे sensory issues have to be checked for the child. So based on the sensory issues, first the sensory system has to be normalized and the child will be able to accept the fruits. Okay. Apart from that, you can start with very small pieces, very, very small piece of whatever fruit you want to introduce with the food item that he's very fond of. So food chaining, as I mentioned, one thing you can start with that, but if there is a sensory issue, he will still figure it out and he will not accept the fruit. So work on the sensory aspect and work on the food chaining.
Ma'am, like I tried it, I tried to give him in very small pieces like apple and banana. And he is starting to doing, he's doing vomit on when he put it in his mouth.
Hmm.
So, ma'am, I tried many times, but but it doesn't work, ma'am.
Ma'am, वो sensory issue होगा definitely, तभी वो accept नहीं कर पा रहा है, probably hypersensitivity होगी. उसको apple के piece को बहुत छोटा सा grate करके, आप जो भी वो खाना पसंद करता है, rice वगैरह, उसके साथ बहुत छोटा सा एक piece रख के और उसको खाने को दीजिए पहले, और धीरे-धीरे उसका size बढ़ाइए. पहले grated form से शुरू करिए. ठीक है और उसका सेंसरी इशू आप चेक करवाइए और उसको रिजॉल्व करिए देन दिस प्रॉब्लम विल बी रिजॉल्व्ड.
हेलो मैम,
आई थिंक पेरेंट्स विल बी टेकिंग अप दिस लास्ट क्वेरी एज वी आर रनिंग आउट ऑफ टाइम. सो डॉक्टर ने आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू काइंडली टेक अप दिस क्वेरी देन इफ
यस मैम.
सजेस्ट मी सेंसरी,
सॉरी
मैम, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ टेस्ट यू सजेस्ट मी फॉर माय सन सेंसरी?
मैम टेस्ट नहीं होगा है, सेंसरी असेसमेंट होता है, ओरोमोटर असेसमेंट होता है, उसमें पता चल जाता
है. ओके मैम, ओके, थैंक यू सो मच.
लास्ट क्वेश्चन मैम, मैम दिस इज एक्सीलेंट प्रेजेंटेशन मैम, अ लॉट ऑफ टर्मिनोलॉजीज आई केम टू नो व्हिच आई वाज नॉट अवेयर बिफोर. सो मैम माय चाइल्ड हैज नो फीडिंग इश्यूज एट ऑल, just that I think he has hypo based on what I understood your presentation, because he constantly asks for chewing gum or apples that are kept in the refrigerators or cucumber or carrots, and he always eats healthy food, but these are the items he enjoys, and in this is in between meals. So okay. Meals, he has proper meals, like you know, absolutely no issue. So this is a sensory issue.
It can be a sensory issue, and we cannot truly you know, summarize it as a tactile issue, because from what you are telling, I am suspecting a proprioceptive component. Okay.
Oh, okay.
So it can be a proprioceptive need of chewing. Is he mouthing also? Does he mouth things?
Ma'am, he wants me to like kind of pull his cheeks and, you know, good apply pressure on his cheeks. So definitely what you're saying is right. You know, he is not getting the input. Looks like. So ma'am, I would like to consult with you one-on-one on this. So can I email you on that ID?
Yeah, sure. You can email us and we'll get back to you.
Because ma'am, he's very less sounds he has, and he's like, you know, we are concerned about his speech, because it's 5 point, he's just 5 now. Okay. So we still have time. We do not want to delay it. So we will get in touch with you.
Sure.
Thank you, ma'am, for the excellent presentation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, parents. Thank you, Dr. Neha. And I hope we could able to answer most of the queries, and those queries who have not been answered or who want us to take the consultations privately, they can drop us an email at gigglesclinics@gmail.com. That is gigglesclinics@gmail.com, or they can WhatsApp us at 8178163066. We have dropped this on our chat box, so parents can kindly go through that. Thank you, parents. Thank you, Dr. Neha.
Thank you, sir.
Wonderful presentation. Thank you, everybody.
Have a good day.